Welcome to School Matters. February is a big month. We'll hear about FAFSA February, learn about some prominent African-American leaders, visit Hale School, and find out about some unique summer employment opportunities for Minneapolis youth. Stay with us. Did you know that there are 7 ways to help pay for college? Number 1, savings. Number 2, family support and current income. Number 3, grants. Number 4, scholarships. Number 5, work study. Number 6, loans. And number 7, community or military service. But the very first step, no matter what route you take, is to complete your free application for student aid, also known as the FAFSA. Counseling offices at each Minneapolis high school are teaming up with Achieve Minneapolis Career and College Centers to help students fill out their forms.
Filling out the FAFSA is an important step on your road to college. We call this FAFSA February.
FAFSA stands for the Free Application for Federal Student Aid.
Research tells us the number one indicator whether or not you're going to go to college is FAFSA completion.
Students who complete the FAFSA have access to 3 different types of aid from the government: work study, grants, and loans.
It's important to get your FAFSA done in a timely manner. Filling out the FAFSA is going to give you a lot of opportunities in determining what college you're going to be attending.
It was important for me to fill out the FAFSA because me being in middle class, my parents make too much money to apply for a lot of the good scholarships. So FAFSA gives me the opportunity to actually get the help I need to pay for college, since I can't get that help through a lot of scholarships.
By not filling out the FAFSA, you will not be eligible for any state or federal grants or for federal student loans. You have to use the FAFSA and the information that the FAFSA produces to make a decision about going to college. Because if you don't have that information in regards to the money in front of you, how can you make an educated decision on what's the best fit for you?
I, however, got accepted into Hamline, and Hamline is a very pricey college, but now that I've applied for FAFSA and got the help that I need, I can choose to go there if I still want to.
Completing the FAFSA is easy. If you can create a Facebook account, you can complete the FAFSA.
By providing the following information, counselors can easily and efficiently help you complete the FAFSA: a Social Security number or a UCIS, last year's tax information, information on savings, investments, and business or farm assets, and records of any untaxed income.
One important thing to remember when filling the FAFSA out online is that you will need a PIN number. Parents who have a student in college or are a student themselves will already have this PIN and will use the same one for both FAFSAs. Filling out the FAFSA is free. You should never pay for anyone to help you fill out the FAFSA or to submit your FAFSA. Free is in the title, Free Application for Federal Student Aid.
Here's some information to help you.
Students and families, we're here to help you. If you have any concerns in filling out the FAFSA, please contact us.
First, I went to go talk with my counselors to learn about what FAFSA is, because if you don't know what it is, it's not a good idea to just go through with the websites and things if you don't know directly where to go. I also got help from my parents getting all the forms and my Social Security number and anything else that I needed to complete the FAFSA, because it's a pretty lengthy process, but it's not hard to do.
Once you complete the FAFSA, a student aid report will be generated. That student aid report will be used to determine your financial aid package. Filling out the FAFSA will save you money.
And remember, your future starts when you fill out the FAFSA.
Very important to think about your future, because we are the future for our country. We have to be educated and be able to have the education to get good jobs to pay for our futures.
The application period for next fall starts now. For more information about applying to college, visit your high school counseling office or visit getreadyforcollege.org. Did you know that February is Black History Month? 3 of our Minneapolis public schools were named after prominent African-American women who have made significant contributions to education. Let's watch this inspirational video.
There's been so many things that's held us down, but now it looks like things are finally coming around. I know we've got a long, long way to go, and where we'll end up, I don't know. But we won't let nothing hold us back. We're putting our shirt together.
we're polishing up our rag doll. And if you've ever been held down before, I know you refuse to be held down anymore. No stopping, 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 say no stopping.
Lucy Craft Laney was an educator in Georgia. She was born to parents who had purchased their own way out of slavery. So her father's name was David. He purchased his own way out of slavery first, and then he purchased his wife's way out of slavery. So their children were born during slavery times, but outside of slavery. Lucy wanted to be an educator. There were not a lot of African American houses and schools for education, and so she wanted to be an educator. She went to school to become a teacher. She had the first kindergarten African American group in Georgia, and she grew that group into her own school. She lacked the resources to keep a school running, and so her only tie to Minneapolis and North Minneapolis is that she came up to Minnesota for a National Presbyterian Conference at Fourth Baptist Church, where Fourth Baptist Church used to be, which is now where our central offices are on 1250 West Broadway. I opened the school year out and I talked to the students, staff, and even our families about the legacy that Lucy Craft Laney left for us. When she came and visited the North Side, bringing her school, her passion, and her vision to continue her school and to keep her school rolling and funded, she was actually turned down. When she presented her case and was looking for support, financial support, she was actually told no. And there was a Northsider by the name of Francine E. Haynes that couldn't kind of get Lucy Craft Laney out of her mind. And so she decided to make a trip to Georgia, went down, visited her school, and took the dollars that her recently deceased husband had left for her and committed them all to Lucy Craft Laney and her school. So the connection between Lucy Craft Laney, the woman, and North Minneapolis is the funding to keep her dream alive. What I always try to highlight is that she had a dream, she believed in herself, she believed in her dream, and she followed that dream and she pursued it. And even when she was first told no, she didn't give up. She just kind of brushed her shoulders off and kept it moving. And she was found faithful and resources did come up. And so that's where I say that we continue her legacy. We are not going to be defeated and discouraged. Even if we're told no at first, we're just gonna kind of brush our shoulders off and we're gonna keep moving in the right direction and our actions will be shown faithful and they will come out in the end. So Lucy Craft Laney, you have left us a legacy that we have strived to build up and maintain every single day that we're here. We hope that we have made you proud. We hope that you, when you look down, you smile upon us. And we hope that what you see in every single one of us and in every single one of our kids is what you attempted to build when you were here with your students.
Mary McCleod Bethune was a civil rights leader and an educator. She was born to parents who were slaves, so she began working in the fields when she was 5. She started school at age 10, and that's when she began to learn how to read. And from there, she wanted to be a black missionary. And when she was told that black missionaries weren't needed, she then decided to become a teacher. And her first teaching position was at the elementary school in which she attended. And then she said that is when it opened her mind to the world. She started a school for African American girls in Daytona Beach, Florida. Mary McCleod Bethune focused all of her work around her philosophy of living and serving. Whenever she found a need, she found something or created something to meet that need. Her vision was peace, progress, brotherhood, and love. So in her last will and testament, she willed to everyone the thirst for education. And we really work hard to make sure that our students take advantage of the opportunities of education and that can open up a world for them as they will be our leaders in the future.
Nellie Stone Johnson was a community activist and organizer. She grew up in rural southern Minnesota And she grew up during a time where there wasn't a lot of diversity. And so growing up as an African-American child, I'm sure the struggles that she faced were extremely challenging. But she did believe in hard work and the power of work equals opportunity. She did own her own business for 30 years. She was a seamstress, and her business was in downtown Minneapolis. And she took those experiences to fight for civil rights. I know that she was a strong advocate for civil rights, and again, she really believed in the importance of equal opportunities for all people, hard work, and education, access to quality education. She was an elected official, one of the first African American women elected in the city of Minneapolis. She worked with the libraries, and I am very pleased that we have such a wonderful, beautiful library that our students have access to. And I think that's kind of the tenets of who she was, that hard work equaled opportunities, and everyone should take their education very seriously. And I think that's one of the things that our staff and our students at Nellie Stone Johnson believe in. If Nellie Stone Johnson were to walk through our building today, she would be very pleased with the type of programming that we have at Nellie Stone Johnson.
To learn more about events this month, visit our website at mpls.k12.mn.us. Did you know that the City of Minneapolis has an employment program for students to gain work experience? Let's find out more about the STEP-UP program. STEP-UP is the City of Minneapolis jobs program for young people and one of the best youth employment programs in the country. In partnership with Achieve Minneapolis, STEP-UP has provided internships for over 16,000 young people with top Twin City businesses, nonprofits, and government agencies.
This is the time to take advantage of opportunities that are in front of you with a lot of the Minneapolis employers that we work with. Go to your schools. We're located throughout your schools. We've got career counseling centers within the schools, the Minneapolis high schools, that can direct you and show you exactly how to get involved in our programs.
All STEP-UP interns receive work readiness training and great opportunities to explore their career interests, gain on-the-job skills, and make strong professional connections for the future.
What I like best about STEP-UP is that you can work in whatever job field you want to and whatever one you choose. I chose to work in broadcasting, and it's just something that I want to do when I grow up too. I want to be a news anchor, so it was just a perfect internship that will help me.
This is absolutely the place to start. You hone different skills that you're going to learn not only on the job, but you're going to learn a lot of life skills as well that'll follow you throughout your career. It's just intangible types of opportunities that you have within the organizations to make a real difference. You also get a chance to actually make money while you're doing this.
And you know, a lot of people don't hire at like 16 and 14 through 16 when they can hire someone who's like 18. So STEP-UP actually really helps with that because, you know, it gives young kids a chance to, you know, actually have a job and learn how to save money and how to, like, you know, take care of things they wouldn't be doing for a little while, so.
STEP-UP employers gain the satisfaction of mentoring talented young people in our community and helping to build a skilled and diverse future workforce for our city.
Our STEP-UP interns work in a number of capacities here at MTN, and they really build the capacity of our organization to serve different populations.
We're responsible for all the different aspects of producing what we make here. Writing, filming, casting, and my favorite part, editing.
They are working currently on their own documentary projects, short 5-minute videos on local community issues. The STEP-UP program also trains them prior to even placing them in the job, which is incredibly helpful for the nonprofit or the organization because you know that they have basic skills that they need to be productive in a professional environment. I hope that the interns take away necessary professional skills that they can be successful in their future endeavors, and I think that's beneficial for everyone in our community.
The advantage of an organization in having a STEP-UP youth be a participant in their program is A, you're getting fresh new ideas from youth that you may not normally be able to, you know, to interact with. B, it's a good look for the organization to know that you're in the grassroots of really putting this child into the path of success. And the students also are going to give you that same respect once they go through their training that we provide. And you know, to hopefully really understand what it is that they want to do long term.
The most important thing about getting a job with Step Up is that you have to apply. You know, you can't get a job if you never apply. So, you know, and they actually try to get back to you and they try as best as they can to, you know, make sure that you have a job.
There's opportunities within law, healthcare, banking and finance, and things like that, so they can really get their feet wet and really understand what those industries are like and understand all the different opportunities that fall within those industries. So this is a great area to hone those skills, create those relationships, and just grow as a person and put yourself to be in a better position to contribute back to the city of Minneapolis in the long run. So please go online and get your applications in early. There's a huge demand for these opportunities here. Everybody wants to take advantage of it and make a difference in their lives. So we encourage you to go online and seek that application and get it completed as soon as you can.
To find out how to become a Step Up intern or employer, visit www.achieveminneapolis.org or call 612-455-1530. Applications are due March 4th. To close our show this month, we traveled to South Minneapolis to find out why Principal Lily Payne loves her school.
Hi, welcome to Hale School. I'm the Principal Lily Payne. Hale is a K-4 school in Minneapolis. We have 650 students. We have two classrooms with students with a disability of autism who are mainstreamed in our mainstream classrooms. We truly are a community school. Come with me and I'll show you. Hi, at Hale School, we have a veteran staff who knows how to meet the needs of all our students, whether they need support or whether they need enrichment. We're very lucky here because we do have such a talented staff. Our students come very well prepared, and the curriculum is filled with rigor as well as support to scaffold students into learning. Our students achieve, our students do well. Our students are supported by their families as well as by support staff in the building, aides who help, paraprofessionals, the secretary, the nurse, the engineers. It's all a great place to be with really high standards and real heart. And we're very proud of that at Hale. At Hale, we're integrating technology into the curriculum. We have iPads as well as three computer labs that help our students learn and explore the world and really become global citizens. At the end of the 4 years of being here at Hale, your child will have a quality education, they will make friends, they will be able to meet the academic needs that face them in middle school, and they'll be able to build strong relationships and have skills that they can share with each other and the world. So we're very proud of the work that we do here at Hale. We're very proud of our faculty, our staff, and especially our students, and most importantly, the support that we have from their parents. I've been in education since 1977 as a teacher, started out as a kindergarten teacher. Taught every grade level from kindergarten through 12th grade, overseas across the United States. Times have changed. I've seen curriculum change. I've seen children change. I've seen communities change. Still, the core of all of it is that every child, it's our responsibility that every child learn. And I believe we're doing that at Hale. Because of our great teachers, because of our wonderful students, and our helpful parents, we are meeting the mark now in the 21st century, and I'm very proud to be a part of it, and I'm very proud to be here at Hale School.
That's all for this month. Remember, you can watch School Matters every month on Minneapolis Cable Channel 15 or see all our shows at mpls.k12.mn.us. I'm Bianca Rhodes. Thanks for watching.